encourage you all to come, because the message is good. He is really feeding us the word, and it's helping.
Amen.
Because every single day it looks like the devil is just something going on always. If it's not in front of you, it's somebody else. And if, when you care for your brother, it can stress and give you that anxiety. But to know, to trust in Jesus.
Amen.
'Tis so sweet.
Yes.
He is our stress reliever, and Pastor has given us a word on that. So please make a point to come on Wednesday nights at 6:30. Our step practice will be Thursday at 5:30 p.m. Leadership meeting is on Sunday. It will be the fourth Sunday of this month. That's April 24th. So all of our leaders, Pastor is asking us to stay a little while after church downstairs in Fellowship Hall so that he can discuss some important things with us. Okay, get ready for May Day at the PM. Hallelujah. May Day, everybody knows, or if you don't know, if you're visiting for the first time, May Day is a community event that we do here on our campus. So invite your friends, invite your relatives, invite people who need Jesus, people who don't need Jesus, the community, especially if you live in Trustville. Please reach out to people that you go to school with, Walmart, or wherever your people are. Just invite them to come out, because we'll have plenty of things to do for kids and the adults. And I've reached out to our team and say, you know, give us something to do too, because I play a game. You know, I will.
Amen.
My mom, Deanna's like, Mom, what you going to play? I play something. Y'all think about me when y'all got the game. Yeah, I can kick mom. You might go a little to the left, but I can. Okay, and that would be May 21st. So put that on your calendar, Saturday, May 21st, from 10 to 2. On April 16th at 10 o'clock, the Alabama Sports Hall of Fame will be hosting its Crossover Youth Male Empowerment event. Crossover is an event catered to males in grades 7, 8, and 9. If you have a son interested in attending, please see Minister Lovelace. Raise your hand, Minister. And Deacon Mullen. Raise your hand. For more information. So if you have young men in that age group, 7th, 8th, and 9th, please see them, because I believe this will be a very powerful event for our men. We have to invest in our young men. Amen. We have to invest in our young men. Amen. We have some wonderful deacons. I know my husband is wonderful, but I believe the other ones are too. And I know where seed he come from. His mama didn't play. And she has taught him well. There was no dad in the house, but I got a good man.
Amen.
You gotta invest in your young men so that women like me can have a good man at the house with her. Okay. But no, seriously, we do. We have to do that. We have to. Okay, our young people, if you're interested in the choir singing, please see me after church, okay? If you don't worry about it, if you can sing, if you can't sing, don't worry about it, if you're shy, if you're not shy. I promise you, you will get over that. It just takes a little time, and I'm here to help you, okay? When I was growing up, we had a choir stay at Fool. It was teenagers and all kinds, because the guys was there because the girls was there. So some of you might be looking for boyfriends. See, our deacons, they're going to, in our ministry, they're going to take the guys, get empowered so they can know how to treat you. Okay? So you've got to come here so you can learn what to do too for Jesus. Because let it be told, women in the house, we keep the praise going up. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So it all works together. So we're doing all we can for Christ to move the kingdom. Amen? So see me after church, young people, if you would like to sing. Any visitors? Would you please stand? We have a treat for you. Please stand.
Thank you.
before you, and we ask that you will read it and fill it out, and please feel free to come at any time. Amen. It's giving time. Hallelujah. It's giving time.
Glory to God. Time to give, Jesus. All right, may we all stand to our feet. We're going to repeat our tithers' confession and our givers' confession. Hallelujah. We're going to start with our tithers' confession. Repeat after me. I am a tither.
I am a tither.
I tithe. Follow the leadership of our greeters and our ushers. And let's get some tithing music. Praise God. For your love right now, dear Heavenly Father. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy, dear Heavenly Father. Thank you just for being a sovereign God, dear Heavenly Father. And as we stay in this imperfect word, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you right now for just being a perfect God. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for these tithes and offerings that was brought before us. Let it not be used for the will of man, but let it be used for thy will only, dear Heavenly Father. For we love you and adore you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Glory to God. We're going to have our hymn faith.
church. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, put your hands together for Jesus, honey. You tapping. Grandmama said, when you clap it, drive the devil away. Put your hands together for Jesus. Ain't nobody got time to be pancaking with the devil. The devil don't like us. Amen. Amen. Come on, to him, faith. No, the hope of our mission statement. Our mission at Hope Everlasting Ministry.
Our mission at Hope Everlasting Ministry
is to encourage people through the Word of God to live out the plan, the purpose,
and the will of God
for our lives. Our faith confession. In my hand I hold my Bible.
In my hand I hold my Bible.
It is the unchanging Word of God. Children will be mighty in the land.
My children will be mighty in the land.
I am the generation of the upright.
I am the generation of the upright.
I will be blessed.
I will be blessed.
Wealth and riches are in my house.
Wealth and riches are in my house.
And the righteousness of God endures forever.
And the righteousness of God endures forever.
I trust God.
I trust God.
For the plans.
For the plans.
And purpose.
And purpose.
He has for my life.
He has for my life.
Lord, today.
Lord, today.
Lord, today. If you're glad about it, put your hands together. Come on, bless the Lord in this place. Come on, bless the Lord in this place.
How many know if God has made a way for you? Out of no way. Out of danger unseen. Travis Green, is called Made a Way. And if you really listen to it, no man, no human being that God has created can make a way for you like God can. And he is the way, he's the truth, and the life. So if he made a way for you, I want you to get by yourself. Don't worry about who on your left, who on your right. Get by yourself. Because half of us could have been dead, sleeping in our grave right now. Half of us wouldn't be here right now. If it weren't for your great-grandparents' prayers, your grandmother's prayers, you wouldn't be here right now. But somebody interceding for you.
Standing here only because you nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this in control, and now we know. And when it looks as if you can't win, He wraps you in His arms and He steps in. And nothing can catch you.
You made a way out of no way, out of no way. Bible said, hey, 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 you're so moving, yeah. Oh God, yeah. Oh God, you're so moving, mountain, yeah. Oh God, you did it for me, chance for me, cause you moving, mountain, yeah. Oh God, yeah. Oh God, yeah. You're so moving, mountain, yeah. Right now, that you cause walls to fall, you cause walls to fall, you cause walls to fall, yeah. Again, you cause walls, you cause, yeah, you cause, yeah, you shoot, yeah. I mean, Lord, the giants fall, and giants. Your giant falls, your giant falls, today he falls, hey, today he falls, hey, today he falls, today he falls, hey, your giant falls, your giant falls, your giant falls, today he falls, right now he falls.
nowhere. Is that your testimony? That walls begin to fall in your life. Is that your testimony? When your back was up against the wall, that God made a way. I'm here to tell you, He made a way for me today. He made a way for me. We all seem to be lost. He made a way. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Oh, my God. Oh, hallelujah. Blessed be the name of our God. Blessed be the name of our God. It is an honor and it's a privilege to stand before you today. I talked to Pastor before we opened up service, and Pastor says he loves you guys. Him and First Lady loved you. He's praying for everybody. He says just keep him up in prayer. So he's went to spend some time with his family, which he deserves to do. That's. And in case you didn't know, my name is Minister Mario Brown, because they keep me out in the back. So I'm out there with your children from ages 7 to 13 on Sundays and Wednesdays, and we have an awesome time. With my children's church people, please stand up in here. Children's church, if you're in children's church and you attend that regularly, or you attend it, stand up. If y'all would give them a great hand of applause, they are an awesome bunch of children. I can tell that they come from great homes. They're absolutely marvelous, man. These are the best children I could have ever asked for. Just want to give honor to God and, who's the head of my life. Just thank God. Thank God for my wife, Gentle. My children here today. Thank God for the brethren here, the deacons and the ministers alike, Deontay, Rock, Walter, Erica, and Minister Jackson in his absence, and Deacon Ed Mullen. Yeah, we prophesying it. Deacon Ed Mullen, him and his family, Deacon Lee Green, who's been gracious to us, my family and myself, Deacon Ronald Hicks, who's always a great guy to call on. Ron is a wonderful guy, man. Just love this guy. Deacon Derek Lockett, who never ceases to have an awesome word for somebody, man. It's just awesome. And just giving, it's something else when you can have people like that, that you can call, that has a word, not just about the Bible, but about life. It's when you get on the phone with older people who know about life, who can tell you and who can help chart the course for you and say, hey, you might not want to do it that way. Let's do it this way. So that's a great thing. Also, before I forget, we have an announcement here. Well, they will be having a meeting for the May Day after church today up here in the choir stand. So Sister Stephanie will be conducting that meeting. So all of the people who are interested in working on that committee or serving in that in any capacity with May Day, so you have to see her for that. We heard that announcement. Let us govern ourselves accordingly. Like they say in the old church, the old bishop would say, let us govern ourselves accordingly. I'm trying, yeah. Okay. As I mount this platform and I stand behind this sacred desk, I'm going to execute the duties of the office of a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captives. So that's what ministers are anointed to do. He anointed you to proclaim good news to the poor, to preach the gospel, to bind up the brokenhearted, to help set somebody free. So that's the job of any minister or man of God. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come low that you come high. All of you, none of me, more of you, less of me. God, stand up in me. God, take hold of my vocal cords today. Allow me to be able to proclaim the good news in this place today, God, that you will be seen, none of Mario, God, but all of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and hallelujah. Okay, if you will stand to your feet for the reading of God's word. If you get your Bibles out and go with me in the book of Joshua. It'll be Joshua, the 24th chapter and the 15th verse. Joshua 24 and 15. And when you have it, say amen. Spot, couple of people. All right. So everybody, it's like they have it. Okay, so hold on. Gotta hold on. Everybody else, hold on. Okay. The word of God records in Joshua 24 and 15, he says, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day of whom you will serve, whether the gods of your forefathers serve beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are living. Joshua makes a proclamation and a declaration. He says, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Turn with me again. I'm sorry. I have one more, and I'm going to let you go. Let you have a seat. Exodus 20 and 5. Exodus 20 and 5. And I just read that really quickly. If you're taking notes, you can just mark down Exodus 20 and 5. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am the Lord your God, and I am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the fathers to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me. Of those who hate me. What the title of this text this morning is Stop the Repayment. If I had to have a subtitle this morning, it would be Stopping the Cycle of the Generational Curse. So he says, Joshua made a proclamation saying that as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. He said that, and I flipped over to Exodus, and in the book of Exodus, he began to give out the Ten Commandments to Moses, and he began to say to them, he said, I'm going to punish the sins of the children for the sins of the, I'm going to punish the children for the sins of their fathers for to the third and the fourth generations for them that hate me. And that word hate means to feel a strong intensity of dislike towards somebody. So God says, and for those who hate me, he's going to punish. He said, you hate me when you don't keep my commandments. Oh, wow. He said, you hate me. But over in Joshua, he began this. Joshua said, for as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. The word household in the Hebrew means generation. As for me and my generation, we will serve the Lord. A lot of times we hear people, we talk about what we call the generational curse. And I know it's a little hit and miss with everybody. It's become a little minute and myopic with a lot of people. They just say, you know, generational, somebody just said. But we're going to dig a little bit into generational curse today. We're going to figure out why you continue to do the same thing over and over again that has been done for previous generations. We're going to figure out what happened. And why was it caused, and how are we going to stop it? That's what we're going to figure out today. One of the things that we have to understand about the generational curse is that there is not a curse without a cause. There is never a curse without a cause. The cause to any curse, especially the cause to the generational curse, is this. Either somebody before you was in idolatry or they were in disobedience. Those are the main two causes of the generational curse. So that means is that there's something going on in your life that's been going on for generations and for generations, and you're trying to figure out why is it continuing to go on. It's because somebody before you, your ancestors before you, they sinned somewhere. And one of the things about sin means to fall short of the glory of God. So they sinned somewhere. They fell short of the glory. And what happened was they either were in idolatry. And idolatry just simply means putting something before God or worshiping another God. Or they were in disobedience. That means when God told them to do something, they didn't do it. So that's why the generational curse, that's how the generational curse is birthed into the generation or birthed into the bloodline. So in me studying this thing out, I'm looking at, oh my God, so that's really what it is that either somebody said no to God when they should have said yes to God, or somebody was putting something before God. Let's just kind of break it in layman's terms. God says start a prayer ministry at 2 o'clock in the morning, and you tell God no, you open yourself up for the curse. and you open up the bloodline for the curse. If God says you need to be at church early Sunday morning, but you say, I got to wash my car, and you said, wait a minute, but in other words, you said, Lord, my car's a little bit more important than you. So I need to figure out what happened. See, a lot of times we associate the generational curse with the symptoms of the curse, and the symptoms of the curse could be just fornication, could be drinking, could be any of that stuff right there, but this is what happens because sin means to miss the mark of God or to fall short of the glory of God, and after sin comes transgression. Transgression is the manifestation of sin. That's what transgressions are. They're the manifestation of sin, and after that comes iniquity. Iniquity is just simply meaning that when we get to that part of iniquity, it means that it's been practiced so much or so in the generational or in the bloodline to it's become a habit or easy to practice. It makes you, that's where the iniquity comes in at. So that's kind of what happened. See, this is what happened somewhere a long time ago because this is what we did as great-great-grandparents. They kept things very quiet in the bloodline. Y'all know some people said, you know, certain stuff happened in your family. And they kept that, they swept that under the rug, they kept that quiet. And what happened was that your parents kept that quiet, and you still trying to figure out, why in the world am I dealing with this? Why do I want to be an alcoholic, or why do I want to be a dope addict? Why am I failing at everything in life? Why can I seem to make it? That was because somebody before you opened the door. See, once a door is open to sin, when the door is open, the enemy has the legal right. See, anytime there's sin committed, when sin is committed and sin is not atoned for, what happens is that the devil has a right to rule. He's not out of his realm. He has that right because sin hasn't been atoned for. So when sin hasn't been atoned for, the devil says, I can wreak havoc for generations to generations. See, what start with you might not end with you. See, your generational curse or your generational blessing will outlive you beyond you. See, when they put you 6 feet deep, what's going to happen is that other generations that come behind you, they will either experience the blessing or the curse. See, we have to be very careful about what we're doing because what we'll do is that we'll cause our children's children to go through. We'll cause our folks to struggle and wrestle with a demon that they know not of. And what it is that some people say, but I'm saved. But that means, but you being saved is a great thing. It's a wonderful thing. But watch, this is what happens. There are still angels of light and darkness that fight over you. There are still things that fight for you because you haven't denounced it. There are still things that has a legal right in your bloodline because it has not been denounced. Nobody has stepped to the curse. Nobody has said, no, we're going to shut this down today. So this is what we discover is that sin is progressive. Sin is progressive from one generation to the next generation. So this is what the devil does. Your great, great grandmama gets pregnant at 15 and has a child. She has one child. She has a daughter who gets pregnant at 16 and has two children. So she has a daughter who gets pregnant at 16 and has three children. So then that daughter has another daughter who gets pregnant, and before 21, they got five children. And then somebody said, how come these people keep having all of these babies out of wedlock? What is going on? And we, because we keep it so quiet, we don't know that great-grandmama had a baby at 16 and she wasn't married. See, we think that granddaddy was always, he's not your original granddaddy. So we keep that under wraps, you know. Then back in the day, they have shotgun weddings for people. So then we're trying to figure out, wait a minute, why is this continuing to go? See, why is the door open? The door is open because somebody a long time ago that said, I'm going to tip and take me a drink. And the devil said, okay, you're going to open the door to that particular spirit. He said, I'm going to rule now. So then you may have taken a drink every once a month. So now you birthed out a whole bunch of alcoholics now. So now somebody got to take a drink every day to operate. See, that's how the enemy operates. See, the devil will keep you longer than you want to stay. He'll make you go farther than you're willing to go. And he'll make you pay more than you want to pay. That's the trick of the enemy. So when we open the door to the devil, we might as well get ready to play his game. See, you're not going to play. The devil is not going to play your game. You're going to play his game. And his game is this right here. You said, devil, I ain't want to take nobody's life. He said, but you yielded to the spirit of anger. He said, but no. He said, devil, I didn't want to be a dope head. He said, but you snorted the cocaine at the party. He said, but no, I just did it a little bit. He said, no, you owe me. See, one thing about it is the enemy, he said the enemy, it said we're looking for payment. And when I say stop the repayment, that means that your sins was already paid for over 2,000 years ago. What the devil will keep you doing is paying again and again. I remember we was at home and we had bought a broom. The broom had broke, and I'm like, I'm real frugal. I'm cheap. I don't want to have to keep doing all that. So I went to the store. We got another broom, and that broom broke. And I kept, went to the Dollar Tree and got this broom. So I kept trying to figure out why all these brooms are breaking. And if anybody is like me, I don't know how many people, we're not going to keep that. So we taped up the broom and trying to hold it up. And I told my wife, I said, we ain't getting another broom. We're going to get a wooden broom. So nobody break the broom. I don't know what's wrong going on around here with these brooms. So as I kept looking, I said, wait a minute, something's up with this. But this is how the enemy operates. He'll make you pay more money than what you anticipated paying. He'll keep generations paying and paying and paying for something that happened over 300 years ago or something that happened 50 years ago. He'll keep you paying for that. So when you start seeing people that do all this crazy stuff, somewhere in the generation of people, that was the door open to that. It was a door. It's either a door open to the curse or a door open to the blessing. See, that's what we have to start. We got to start the blessing, because the plan of the devil is to keep generations after you not from receiving Christ. That's his whole plan. His whole plan is to keep you going through the same cycle and perpetuating the same cycle and keep dragging this thing on and on. And you saying to yourself, why in the world they make it to college, but they don't graduate from college? They make it to high school, they drop out of high school. And that's because somebody before them was like that. So now you done birthed out a generation of uneducated folk. You done birthed out a generation of drug addicts and of whoremongers and all that. And one thing we have to do once we get saved and see the light, we got to tell our children where we came from. You got to tell your children, baby, daddy was a pimp. Mama went to school 3-4 times before I got it right. So you got to tell them, because that same devil is looking for them. So you got to teach them what to look for in the bloodline until it's completely denounced. So you got to tell your children, say, baby, wait a minute, hold up, stop the press, wait a minute. You got to look for this demon, because I'm going to tell you something. Ain't nobody told you. Your great-grandma was really a pill head. So she died prematurely. So in order to keep you from going the same route, let me tell you, the demons we're up against. I just want to talk a little bit to some of the single people in the house today. If you single and unmarried, I just want to talk to you. This is what it is. You know, we hear so much and say, this is what people say. When you get married, you want to get somebody got a wonderful job, and that's cool. You want to get somebody that got a nice car, that got a couple of degrees and all of that. But what you also want to do is you want to check out the bloodline. See, before you walk down the aisle and say I do with somebody, you want to date their mama, their daddy. You want to date the sister, the brother, because you want to figure out what is going on in your bloodline. You want to figure out, baby, wait a minute, are you a molester? Do you come from a whole bunch of molesters? Are you a functional drug addict? Because if you're that, then our children will be that. So you have to figure out what's happening in their bloodline. So you just can't date somebody because their thighs look good, or you can't date somebody because their rims on their cotton eyes. You got to date somebody because, wait a minute, baby, I ain't got that going on in the bloodline. See, that's what the enemy will do you like this here. And if you marry men away and you find out what's in the bloodline, you're in the spirit of delusion at that point. See, the enemy's plan is to keep you in delusion. The enemy plan is to keep you blind to the things. See, it's not that God don't show us, it's that we just refuse to see. It ain't certain stuff that God has never shown us. It's just some stuff that we don't want to see. You know how it is. We be like, Lord, I just don't believe that. I don't believe Big John to do that kind of stuff. But why would Little John do that? But that's because Big John was in prison. What you talking about? We get on the news with certain, I see certain stuff. See, I just can't believe little Leroy gonna act like that. No, big Leroy did that. What you mean? I just don't believe little Jessica gonna did that. Big Jessica did that. Big Johnny did that. See, you got to understand. See, girl, that girl sang just like her mama. Or she just blow up like that's, yeah, you right. That's what was birthed out in the See, you'll find out that great-grandmama was a songstress. You'll find out that great-granddaddy was an educator. You'll find out that your family always had money. See, that's where it is, because see, the enemy wants to keep us in a place where we're not seeing God, we're not hearing God, and we're not obeying God. As long as the devil can keep us right there, then he got us where he wants us to be. He got us in that place where people where folks, you'll hear the truth, but you won't believe it. You'll see what God is trying to show you, but you won't open your eyes to it. See, that's the plan of the enemy. And when we recognize his plan, we got to do a couple of things about that. One thing about the devil's plan was to stop you from getting to where you are today. Some of the people in this place had to jump through hurdles, leap over walls, had to knock people out of the way, and had some people, see, this is the thing about it, and I came to announce to you today, you're not a chip off the old block. No, you're not that. You're not a chip off the old block. You got, and then one of the main vehicles for curses, you guys, if you're taking notes, please write this. The main vehicles are the words of our mouth. We are ensnared by the words of our mouth. You got to be careful when people start speaking into your life, and you got to be careful what you speak over yourself. So you got to see when people start saying, "God, you're gonna be just like your auntie Lisa. She was a drug addict." The devil is a lie. You got to tell them straight up, "No, Big Mom, I love you, Big Mom. You're losing in your age, but the devil is a lie. No. You got to tell some people, no, baby, the devil is a liar." See, and when you begin to get to that place where you get discouraged in your life and you say, "I don't feel like I'm worth nothing," don't say that stuff out loud. Because, see, you give permission for that to live in your life. Those are the main vehicles for what curses continue for generations, is because we speak stuff over our children's children. We speak stuff. Y'all remember that movie, The Five Heartbeats? And in the movie, he said this one particular line that just stood out to me. He said, "I ain't going to be nothing." He said, "You ain't going to be nothing because I want nothing. You ain't going to get me to cuss. Y'all know the movie." And so you remember that movie? So that movie, and that is so serious. If he had any inkling of what that would have done to him in his life, because if you remember the movie correctly, you remember the fact that he was nothing. You remember the fact that he was an alcoholic and his daddy was an alcoholic. That's how that continued to go. Even when he started stepping outside of what the norm was for the family, he started going against the grain, and the daddy stepped to him and said, "Wait a minute." See, the devil was talking to him then. The devil said, "Wait, man, I ain't nothing. You ain't gonna be nothing." And if you accept that, then what happens is that it has that permission to reign in your life. That a spirit, when stuff is spoken out of the mouths of people and you start receiving it, it has a legal right to stay where it is. So it's going to stay there. It's going to connect itself to you. It's going to walk around with you all the days of your life until you break the curse. So as they began to go on, he was kicked out the group. They put him out the group and all that. And I'm sure he got someone in his life that said, "I could have been," or "I could have done this." And we'll get to that place in our life. I could have done this, but before it's too late, we're going to talk about how to get rid of the curse in him. We're going to talk about how we're going to move beyond that day. We're going to talk about that. And one of the things, my first point is this, is you got to acknowledge. You have to acknowledge. You cannot conquer what you don't confront, and you can't confront what you don't identify. You have to acknowledge what it is and where you are with it. You got to acknowledge that, baby. You got to, and then you can't be, don't lie to yourself. "We got a family full of alcoholics. I don't want to be no alcoholic. I don't want my children to be no alcoholic." So we got to acknowledge where we are with that particular curse in our family. Once we acknowledge it and we step to it, then we can break it. I'm going to show you something. If you never see that, the thing about AA, and AA is a good place to go, I guess, for people. But the thing about AA is that in AA, they say is you have to stand up to say, "Hello, my name is Mario, and I'm a drug addict," or "I'm an alcoholic." See, when you acknowledge the fact you're an alcoholic, then we can do something about it. See, some people who you see, sometimes when you start telling people stuff, the reason they don't believe you is because they haven't acknowledged it. They think you're the one with the problem. When you start ministering stuff to people and say, hey, boy, you don't want to go down. You don't want to do that. You don't want to sell drugs. They're looking at you like, what's wrong with you? They thinking that you are the initial problem, but you're not the problem. It's that spirit that's the problem. And after you acknowledge that, after you acknowledge it, you got to repent, and you got to even repent for past generations. That means that you got to say, God, please forgive me for this spirit, but not only this spirit, but God, forgive my granddaddy. God, forgive my great-granddaddy. God, forgive my great-great-great-granddaddy. Because that's what it is. See, the devil never wants you to repent. Because once you repent, it starts the process to the curse breaking. See, the process is now started. The process is now starting when you acknowledge the fact that we got a problem somewhere. We're going to repent of the problem. And the other thing is that you got to apply the blood. You have to apply the blood of Jesus Christ to the situation. You got to apply that blood. You got, and a lot of times, even in applying the blood simply means sometimes you're going to have to cut off some family members. Sometimes you're going to have to cut off some friends. Sometimes you got to stay out of auntie house. Sometimes you got to stay off the phone with cousin. Sometimes you got to tell yourself, no, we ain't going over there, because I refuse to be a part of the curse any longer. See, I'm going to apply the blood of Jesus, because the blood of Jesus is what broke it over 2,000 years ago. See, in order to keep from paying for something two and three and four generations, you got to apply the blood. And once the blood is applied, then the thing can be broken. The curse will be broken. It will come down in your life. You got to start telling the devil, no, I ain't like my daddy. I'm saved, and when I got saved, I got a blood transfusion. And when I got saved, my life got on track. And when I got saved, I'm not like that. I'm sorry if you don't want to speak to me no more. But my life, he said, cursed is the man that hangeth on the tree. He hung on the tree for you and I. He became the curse so you didn't have to be the curse. He became everything so you didn't have. See, all of it is nailed to the cross. See, you got to tell the devil, say, no, devil, you a lie. You a lie, devil. I'm not going to be like that. I refuse to be like that. I refuse to be like generations before me. I refuse to be like my granddad and them. No, we starting a generational blessing. And the Bible talks about, he said, as for me and my house. I don't know about your house, but as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. When your children acting crazy, ask for me in my house. No, you want to perpetuate foolishness, but ask for me in my house. We going to serve the Lord. The Lord has to be served, you guys. See, when the Lord is served, that means the devil has no room. When the Lord is served, that means the enemy don't have a foothold in your house. Oh, my God. Hallelujah. Jesus. Yeah, oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, we done started some up in here now. We got to finish this thing. We got to finish this thing. Jesus, I don't have it like Pastor have it. He got about four or five Sundays for some stuff, but I don't have, I just got one. So we got to finish this thing today. My God. He says in Galatians, he talks about in Galatians that you're redeemed for the curse of the law. He talks about John 8:36. He said, if the Son of Man, you shall be free, you shall be free. He said, who God's made free is free indeed. So you're free from whatever it is. He talks about in Corinthians, therefore, if any man be in Christ Jesus, you are a new creature. He said, behold, all things are passed away. See, I want to let you know, baby, you're a new creature. When you accepted Jesus Christ, you are a new creature. When you when you stood at the altar and said, God, I'm making you the head of my life, I am a new creature, and all things are passed away. See, the enemy can't handle the fact that, no, I'm not going that way. I'm not going there with you no more. Me and you ain't doing that no more. I'm sorry. No, you held up my life too long. You done held up my family too long. You done birthed out all these other folks too long. I'm going to start the generational blessing. And in order to start the generational blessing, you got to align yourself properly with Christ Jesus. How you do that? You got to say yes to God, even when your flesh say no. You got to say, God, no, I'm not putting nothing ahead of you. I'm on my way to the house of the Lord. I'm on my way in prayer. That can wait. All that stuff can wait until you and know, God. Because when I say yes to you, God, I'm going to start the blessing. And guess what? The blessing will outlast the curse. The blessing will flow for thousands of generations. God will have mercy for thousands of generations. He's going to always have that mercy. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. My God. My God, I hear. Man, the Lord is saying in this place, what we're going to have to do, we're going to have to denounce the devil out of our generation. I don't know what it was. I don't know what it is. I don't know what everybody, what anybody is struggling with. All I know is God said, you got to denounce it. You got to stand up and you got to repent for your daddy. You got to repent for your great-granddaddy. You got to repent for generations before you. You got to close that door. Because see, what people don't understand is this here. Folks never understand this here. A sin has to be atoned for because that blood is continuing to cry out. And it's been crying out for generation to generation. When the blood cries out from generation to generation, that means that the devil's saying, I still got it. What he's trying to do, he's trying to get you like them. He's trying to, this is what the devil come to you to say. You know, the devil say, Deontay, you owe me. Deontay said, no, wait a minute, I don't owe you anything. He said, no, you remember? This is what happened. Your daddy was this, your granddaddy was that. He said, no, but I'm not that. He said, no, but you look like him. You smell like him. You came from where they came from. Who are you to think that you're going to come over here and not do what I want you to do? See, that's the plan and the trick of the enemy. The enemy wants you to always think that, and he'll get you with that guilt trip. Everybody in your family, see, Big Mama died of the sugars and all that. No, baby, I ain't got no sugar. I'm sorry. I have a blood transfusion. They died of a heart attack. I ain't dying of no heart attack. He drank himself to death. I ain't drinking myself to death. So I don't know what you're talking about. No, see, you just trying to, you go to that church and trust me, you're trying to be up there. No, baby, I'm sorry. I refuse to be anything like that. You can't, don't allow people to make you feel bad for where you live, what you drive, and where you work, and because God has brought you out. Don't allow nobody to make you feel bad because you chose to break the generational curse. Don't let nobody make you feel bad because you don't let your children hang with them hoodlums in the street. No, I'm sorry, baby. You think I'm all that. I don't think I'm all that. I just think that I'm saved. I think I'm free. I think I am delivered, so I don't have to participate in what the enemy wants me to participate in. So you can tell me, you can say what you want to say about me, but I'm free. I'm made whole. My children are made whole. Their children are made whole. I'm setting up a generational blessing that will outlive me, that will outlive my children's children, because I believe that I'm saved. I believe that I'm different. I believe that I'm free because I accepted Jesus Christ. And when I accepted him, he said, no, son, you don't have to do that because I did it. I hung on the cross, so you don't have to go through. I went through. I was lonely for you. I know what it feel like when folks disinclude you. I know what it feel like when they lock you out. So you're free, baby. I want to let somebody know today you're free. You're free today. Everything that the devil said about you ain't true. Everything that your folks want to do to you, let them do it, baby, because you're free. Not only are you free, your children free. Your children's children are free. We're going to start a generational blessing. We're going to birth out billionaires and millionaires. We ain't birthing out no more drunks, no more drug addicts. We birthing out something that will change the world. We birthing out something that will take over the enemy's camp. We birthing out some stuff. So I'll tell you, say what you want to say. Do what you want to do. But I'm sorry I won't perpetuate the curse with you no more. No, baby, I ain't getting down like that. I don't care if you don't shoot no more dice with me. I don't care if you don't sit at my house for a fish fry. But baby, I ain't going back with you no more. Have it your way. Today is your day. The Bible says that you are made free. Oh my God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh God, somebody give God praise in this place. Somebody give it to him in this place. Oh God. Everybody just stand to your feet for a moment. Stand to your feet for a moment. I want you to repeat after me. God, in the name of Jesus, I decree and declare that every curse out of my generation is broken. I repent for the sins of my father, my father's fathers, my mother's mother. I am free and made whole in Jesus' name. Give God a hand of praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Oh, yes, Jesus.
Yes, hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, oh my God. Man, God got so much for us in store. He got some stuff for us, y'all. He got some stuff for us because we were able to stand up and say, the generational curse is broken. You don't have to struggle no more. You ain't got to wonder about it no more. You ain't got to be what they said you were going to be. As a matter of fact, you're farther than what they said you was going to be. If you're still struggling with some stuff, we're going to be at the altar for you. I'm going to my seat now. I didn't want to keep you long. We're going to be out of here for 12. God bless you. God keep you. And that is my prayer. Hallelujah. Is there anybody here today that don't know Jesus? That means you have not accepted him. You have not yielded your life to Jesus. You don't know him. And if you don't know Jesus, meet me down here at this altar. Don't leave this place today without knowing him. The old preacher said, while the blood is still running warm in your veins, you want to accept Jesus the Christ. If you were to leave this place, heaven forbid, and have a head-on collision, the next face you need to look in will be the face of Jesus the Christ. So if you don't know him, come talk to us today. We'll help you. We'll get you to that place. The job of your pastor and the job of ministers here at this altar, the job of our deacons, is to take the hands of you, your hands, and take God's hands and connect it and let you have a relationship. That's just as simple. But if you know Jesus and you are a backslider, you went back on God and you said some things you had no business saying, and you're still struggling even with the generational curse, if you need some prayer, come down here to this altar. We got some people for you. We got some people down here for you. And also, this is our time of connection. If you don't have a church home, if you don't have a pastor, Dr. Derek Jones would love to be your pastor. He will love to serve God in reference to you. This is a loving church. We're not a perfect church, but we're a church striving to do God's will. So if you're in need of a church home, come meet us down here at this altar. But while you're on your way, we're going to be praying with these people.